For those of you who just joined, my name is Dharani Chandrasekaran. I've been here hosting the session all day, but I'm extremely excited to end our day with this session, this panel. We have two wonderful panelists here, and they're going to tell us how we can more effectively harness the power of machine learning. And during the panel, I will be asking them a few questions, but do keep posting your questions on the app as well. And I will make sure to make time at the end to read them, just like the earlier sessions today. First, we have Saurabh Khanwalkar, who's the VP of Machine Learning at Force Hero. Saurabh, you want to tell the audience a little bit about your work?
Hi, everyone. I work at Force Hero. I lead the machine learning search recommendations and natural language processing groups. Course Hero is a edtech education technology company. We've been around for 10 plus years, and we have hundreds of millions of documents that we are trying to help students learn, to help them graduate faster and more optimally. So we do machine learning across various areas. My background is mostly in research, working on in Raytheon for many years, in DARPA projects, and also in commercial space in edtech and consumer electronics.
Lovely to have you. And next, we have Ignacio Lopez Francos, who's a senior research engineer at NASA Ames Research Center. Do you want to tell us a little bit of what you've been up to?
Sure. Hi, everyone. My name is Ignacio. I'm a senior research engineer at NASA Ames. My main focus currently on the research side is on autonomous applications, especially vision-based applications. Autonomy as well, like looking into safety critical components, very similar to what the previous speaker was talking from Airbus. And also, I'm doing some research on neuromorphic computing for radiation tolerant environments, and also overall computer science. Sort of computer vision for orbital integrated applications.
Okay, lovely. Thank you for both again for joining the panel. We're really lucky to have both of you with such a variety of experience, both from the industry as well as research. So let's get started. And so the first thing I want to ask you both is that we all know machine learning is everywhere, right? We're all at the conference here, right? But also at the same time, there's so much more potential that can be unlocked. And what is, in your view, how is machine learning being held back? And is it probably from a research perspective, or is it more application, or is it more ops? What do you think, Saurabh?
Yeah, that's a great question. If you think about the machine learning development cycle, you start with a problem, and then you have to do research because it's a data-driven solution. So even in research, there is significant gaps with reproducibility of what's happening in academia to be able to have labels for your specific domain. And then when you move from research to more of a dev cycle, the challenges are around how to scale things, how to deploy things. And then once it's in operations, you're thinking about, is my model going to work as it is? Or 6 months from now, it's going to drift to completely different use cases or completely different data patterns are changing over time. So, the challenges are across the board. It spreads across more from, top of the funnel, which is research to deployment, and then operations as well.
Right? Yeah, definitely. Ignacio, anything?
Yeah, I was going to say, we've seen in this last decade how AI and machine learning has permeated pretty much every single industry and every single level of our society and our lives. And obviously with that comes a new different set of challenges, some of the challenges that Sarah mentioned, but also, as machine learning models become more sophisticated, more complex, bigger in size, both in the research side as well as in applications, that comes, more complications and constraints in terms of how much it costs to retrain a model or to even use that for inference. Where do you get big data sets that are AI ready to be trained with, for example? And also, obviously the how that impacts our society. We need to be more conscious about, what are the ethical aspects and how that impacts, if we relinquish our decision making to AI systems, how is that going to impact our society? Those kind of questions need to be sometimes embedded between the prototyping all the way to production. Okay, so those are the kind of questions that I think should be more convincing.
Yeah, there's clearly a lot to unpack here, right? And I loved your framing of thinking of it as like a funnel structure, right? Like so starting from the top of the funnel.
Yeah.
So let's start at the top, right? What better place? Research is obviously the cornerstone of machine learning. All through the day, we've been hearing about the coolest, latest new papers that have been published, right? So what do you most appreciate about the research that's going on, and especially when it's tying to your industry? Yeah.
Okay. I was going to say there's so many things that we can appreciate on the research side for AI. I mean, in my field, coming from NASA, coming from the aerospace industry, I mean, research in AI has enabled us in the last decade to discover new planets, being
right.
able to tap into data sets that before was impossible because we didn't have the computational resources, we didn't have the algorithms to actually go through all that. Vast amounts of data. Just to give you a sense, NASA produces around 2 gigabytes of data every second. That would be impossible
mm-hmm.
with the current methods that we have maybe like 15, 20 years ago. And not only that, I mean, if we look also in industry, I mean, we have the big AI labs, for example, DeepMind and Sumirana, they just, you know, we're able to basically map the protein structure at the molecular level. That can enable, for example, drug discovery. And going back, for example, with the talks that we had previously on autonomy, you know, thanks to AI, thanks to the research in AI, we were able to, you know, last year land perseverance in March, for example.
Right.
So I think that's pretty exciting.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think just to add, I think let me give an example of evolution, right? I was doing work in speech recognition in like 2009 and 2010,
mm-hmm.
and there were really no data sets out there, right? Most of the work was happening in DARPA, IARPA, mostly government projects. And then around 2014, you know, speech recognition became sort of a solved problem because we had, you know, the Echoes and the Alexas coming
mm-hmm.
out. And, you know, it's because of, people don't know, but last 20 years, government was investing in research. And that suddenly became like to a state where consumers can actually accept the error rate so that they can actually have speech recognition as a product. The same thing happened with natural language processing around 2015, which sort of made me shift from research going into more into production because now we started seeing that NLP and the large language models that you know a lot of people are presenting today, like BERT and ELMO and things like that, sort of change the state of going from zero to one in a startup or a small company or even a bigger company for many use cases. So that sort of changed the whole ballgame because now we're talking about somebody coming in and getting seed funding and you know having an MVP within a few months because
right.
they can take a model off the shelf, go to a model zoo like Hugging Face and you know have something to present and pitch, which wasn't possible even 10 years ago. So it's a big change. And it's mostly driven by research and mostly driven by data being available to actually accomplish that research.
Yeah, definitely. And even today we had a lot of presenters talk about how their work is now open source.
Yeah.
So that's great. Next, I want to actually talk to you. Like, obviously we know the pros, right? Like we've talked about how research is applicable to all
yeah.
of your industries. But are there specific challenges translating that cutting edge research, right? Like this week we had talks about papers that were published late 2021, right? Like so quick, the turnaround time. So what are the challenges there translating that to your industry? Sort of you want to?
Yeah, there's many challenges, right? But just to list a few, the initial touched upon it, like reproducibility. You know, there's like, the cool thing is everybody's publishing papers with code. So there's a GitHub link for everything. But then when you try to reproduce it, either the labels are missing or some code is missing. And then if you can't reproduce it, then you sort of lose that trust in the numbers that are being published in papers.
Mm-hmm.
And then it sort of takes a step back from an industry perspective. If a company has a runway for 6 months and they can't even reproduce the results, but they can't even create a product on top of that. So that sort of becomes a key blocker for something to go from zero to one. The other challenges, obviously, are labeling. Data exists out there, and there was for a while it was like big data, a lot of data, and then we go task specific. You want to obviously have labeled data, how do you get labels? You know, every label is expensive. I mean, there are vendors, and we have some in our booth, in our expo, or just summit. But it's still a challenge to actually do that at scale. And then, like just a couple of weeks ago, in my company, we are trying to solve a problem around semantic search and recommendations. And we started with BERT, and then we are like, but to build something for our specific use case, which we are talking about students coming from different schools and different subjects, because we are a vertical search engine, their intents are different. So just having a model that's built with data from the web is not that good enough for a product, right? It works, but then it starts breaking when we start getting customer feedback that I'm searching for something and it's returning something. I'm looking for matrix multiplication, it's returning the results from matrix the movie, right? So that's a completely different domain. So it's really challenging to actually, shape that open source research and models into something that becomes a marketable product. And then you're talking about monetization, that's a completely different model.
Okay. Ignacio, like how, at NASA, it's obviously the way that you guys approach research and industry is different than a private company, right? So for you, working at NASA, what are the challenges similar to what Saurabh said, or are they different? Like how?
I think I completely agree with the reasons that Saurabh exposed. We did see those on the research side also before even going into production or into an application or in the business side. The lack of AI-ready data sets. As I said before, the nice thing of NASA is that it's multi-domain. There are many specialties. You have different divisions, for example, in physics, sciences, planetary science, and all of them are collecting tons and tons and tons of data. But sometimes they act in silos as well. So one of the issues that we've seen is like, how can we maybe create more AI-ready data sets so that we don't duplicate work? For example, there's some data sets from the moon that maybe specific missions are working with, but every mission may be really working in silos, and they may be developing some pre-processing tools, so like removing the noise, or like, doing some pre-processing and cleaning up with the data. And usually when we open source things, in general in the field of AI and in the scientific field, we tend to open source maybe certain parts of the code, in machine learning, for example, would be the models, but not that much of other artifacts in AI. For example, what are the pre-processing steps or the APIs that you've been using to download the data or to pre-process the data or to clean it up? There's also not that much improvement in terms of documentation and cataloging of data sets. I think there needs to be some effort on that, mainly because they're not the right incentives. Like usually when researchers work for a project, they publish the paper, maybe they publish in GitHub their code, but there are maybe not that many incentives to maintain the code or to make sure, they follow proper standards so it's not gonna break afterwards. So that's just to name a few. And obviously the aspect of data labeling and getting the right data, I think that's critical as well. It's good that there are many companies out there where you can outsource labeling of data, especially when you have such large amounts of data. And in so many cases, you really need to involve a subject matter expert, the domain experts to help you have high quality labels. And that's usually really hard to find.
Yeah, and expensive. Yeah, I think that's an excellent point. Like, you can ask somebody to label whether this document is spam or not, but then if you ask somebody to label that, is this document about linear algebra or something about physics, thermodynamics, because they're both involving math equations, and unless there's an expert there, you're gonna get some like, okay, it's both, it's math and physics, I don't know. So we face that a lot.
And of course, experts are expensive,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
It's not cheap. So when we're talking about these kinds of challenges, right, how does that affect, how does that affect the industry directly, like in terms of maybe, or how does it affect startups differently versus a bigger company or a company that has been around for a long time?
Yeah, great question. Let's talk about big companies, right? So I used to work in Raytheon. I also worked at a company called Bose that makes headphones. I think the challenge at bigger companies is always sort of PII and making sure that the data that you're using in the models is secure, is GDPR compliant, and also the labels are very specific to a use case. So as Ignacio was saying, that you know, you can have different teams in silos, and that happens a lot in companies. Then how do you create this where one team already collected labels, but the other team also started collecting the labels for the similar task, maybe not the exact same. So how do we leverage that? That's a big challenge, and sort of those problems perpetuate, right? So then over time, what happens is the trust in AI sort of degrades, and then you go all the way up to CIO levels, and they're like, well, we invested AI as a strategy, and it's not working. It's not working because of these sort of processes that don't exist, rather than AI doesn't work, right? But that's the assumption. So that happens in big companies. In startups, if you take the extreme opposite, they have a limited runway. You're talking about, you know, companies that go with .ai domain names. So, you know, there are a lot of expectations. You know, the pitch has a lot of expectations built in it. And, you know, to build a demo from open source models, from Model Zoo, it's easy. But to sustain over, you know, growth and traffic and different kinds of user segments as they start rolling things out is different. Things start breaking. Things don't scale. And then actually what you thought might work as a benchmark data set for 1,000 users, actually you know, sample population bias that kicks in, and then the model is completely drifting. So then you, by the time you realize that, you run out of funding, right? Mm-hmm. So that's the challenge,
To add to what Scott was saying, definitely, you know, you're a startup, not just working in MVP applications, but also in computer vision that requires large amounts of data, label data, and high quality as well. Yeah, you can rely on outsource to third-party companies to help you with that labeling process. But the problem, and we've seen that recently at NASA, what I mentioned before, the lack of subject matter expert. We're trying to basically map water streams in orbital imagery.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something very important, and we have to rely on experts from USGS to help us basically label at the pixel level, you know, some images that we can then, you know, try to use for training. But the problem is, like, obviously you can label, you know, an entire collection of, let's say, the US map of rivers. So we were looking into solutions, for example, like Snorkel, or other open source solutions that leverage what's called weekly supervision, which essentially is you label a few data sets and sort of provide a supervision signal to help you on using just some probabilistic learning to basically classify certain images that may have the same label. But, you know, going into industry again, we recently saw Tesla, how they started using a third-party company for labeling the camera images, and they just a few years ago they shifted to, you know, in their spirit of full vertical integration, to create their own team and basically own that aspect of labeling. But obviously, you know, they have around 1,000 people working right now on labeling. That's impossible for the scale of a startup, right? To do that. So. Those are some of the challenges, specifically for companies that don't have the you know, the capital of a company like Tesla to it's impossible to do that.
Yeah, that makes sense. So Ignacio, I did have another question for you about Tesla. So obviously you guys operate in a very different fashion to a for-profit company, right? In the sense that what takes you from, can you tell us a little bit more about the process that you have for, like, certification or things like that, especially when it comes to NASA research? How do you guys handle that? Like, when do you decide? How do you decide the regulations and
that's a good question. I mean, in general, and in all the engineering disciplines, in this case, like in civil aerospace engineering, for example, there's a very well-defined processes, standard tests, standardization of tests, to ensure that whatever systems you develop are safety critical and they provide with, you know, optimal and high quality results. First of all, the software engineering process is usually more, prototyping and experimenting and iterating. It's very linear. So it doesn't have maybe the same due diligence that you will have when you develop an engineering system. And the second part, ML systems, ML algorithms, they learn from data. And that brings, uncertainty and bias. It's very hard to predict, what's going to be the behavior of a system when it interacts and you deploy it into the real world. So sort of bounding on that uncertainty aspect, that's something that is very challenging right now. I mean, we hear before again from Boeing how they're having troubles, and it's one of the hardest areas right now to certify the vision AI systems. And that's something that I feel like, agencies like DARPA, the FAA, DARPA, for example, had a program that's called Assurance Autonomy that aims to develop tools and frameworks to validate and verify AI systems, but at the same time, be able to standardize the process and at the end of the day, like make safety critical AI systems like that. But it's still a process. It's not solvable. There are still a lot of research going into that. And that's why it's taking so long maybe to certify these AI-based systems like in aircraft or even spacecraft as well, because they need to be robust and safety critical.
Gotcha. Yeah, we had a poll earlier today. I'm not sure if you were aware, and everybody pretty much agreed that safety and regulation, regulation was one of the bigger challenges. So I think the audience probably agrees with you as well on that. So we talked about a bunch of challenges, right? So how do you think some of these challenges can be solved? So can you talk a little bit more about what kind of collaborations you might want to see?
Yeah, so good question. So I think let's talk about areas, right? Like in research, I think one thing that I would like to see more is use case specific publications. So we all talk about a really new model for summarizing text or new model for detecting, people versus vehicles or things like that. But it's not really a use case. If you think about use case, it's very targeted, which is for, let's take a very simple example, maybe let's take Twitter, right?
Right.
Use case in Twitter is you want to predict what, one of the use cases could be you want to predict what topic is trending or what topic is being discussed, right? So you want a model that predicts that, but for a specific reason. So the reason for that topic trending detection is, well, we want to do some alerts, or we want to create some events or things like that. So that's called sort of targeted use case specific AI. Right? So if more research was sort of published, or even the papers with code was published with that as an umbrella, or there was a papers with code zoo where I can, as an industry person, if I get some product requirements, I can find open source models that are targeted towards use cases, then I can at least pitch it. I can do that first mile and build an MVP very quickly, right? So that's something that doesn't exist right now. It's like search on Google, find 20 different GitHubs. Some of them don't even have code, or some of them are like in a language that is not production ready. So there's all these engineering challenges as well, right? And then you go all the way into deployment and operationalization, or operations even. It's like, how do you scale things for, 10 million users, 50 million users? How do you operate in cloud with, Nishir was talking about, there's technology readiness levels in research in government space. Similarly, in industry, there is regression tests, there's A/B tests. How do you scale that to millions of customers? Where they have different intents. So those challenges exist because you're starting with a research software that hasn't really been, battle tested for these kinds of changing dynamic environments, right? So you always hear that, AI model that was deployed was making mistakes because it hasn't actually been tested as much as you would test like an autonomous flight trying to land, right? And we accept to live with it. We accept to live with Alexa making errors, and then we actually correct Alexa, and then Amazon trains uses that data to train it and make it better, which is great, but then it did make a mistake, right? This is a product that I paid for that made a mistake.
Right, right, right. Yeah, definitely. I think back when I was working on Alexa at Amazon, when the first ever iteration, I would take a device home and I would keep talking to it, and sometimes I was like, man, I don't know when we're going to ship this,
yeah.
But I mean, eventually it did get shipped. So the other question I wanted to ask was, you spoke about, Ignacio, I think you were talking about like challenges in creating, having good documentation and for not just the code, but also what the data is supposed to represent, et cetera. Can you talk a little bit more about that and maybe the Open Science Initiative?
Yeah, absolutely. As I mentioned before, like some of the challenges that we've seen on the research side was just like lack of available AI data sets or AI-ready data sets for, you know, for training. Also, you know, sometimes lack of documentation and sharing of different, basically like lack of even standardization on how to share, in this case, like models and data sets, right? But also like lack of maybe financial incentives or funding to maintain and, you know, release not just meet the data, but also like other AI artifacts, like as a service of like processing pipelines, etc. So one of the cool initiatives that, that NASA is really working on is called the Open Science Initiative. And as you know, like NASA has been releasing data openly since the 90s, basically for every mission that we sent, outside in the States, but also, you know, on Earth, we always release that data.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that this initiative, what it aims is more of an internal initiative to create that set of standards, and also to create a culture of more open sharing. So basically, when domain scientists and, you know, ML researchers are working on a problem, have that incentive in mind when they're you know, trying to solve the problem or like conducting research, have more in mind that, you know, maybe all the parts of the research, not just the data set, is going to be published afterwards. So it's a way to accelerate that scientific discovery and also to educate more of the people outside to really know what's, you know, what's going on in NASA and what is the science that is being.
Yeah, wonderful. Hopefully we can continue doing that, right? I did want to ask also, so we talked about this, the different approaches that research has versus the industry has, right? So how can, do you, either of you have thoughts on how that gap can be bridged apart from just doing this open source? Either of you can start.
Yeah, so one of the things that I've seen that are successful to bridge the gap is creating more partnerships between academia and industry.
Mm-hmm.
The same way within NASA could be between private industry and public or government. I think, you know, bringing people from outside with different perspectives, I think is something super valuable. Also like creating and facilitating research by bringing interdisciplinary researchers work together. For example, can you bring domain scientists, planetary scientists with ML researchers, software engineers to help, you know, tackle a highly narrow problem, a very specific challenge. And there are lots of programs, you know, privately and publicly funded initiatives. And one of them that I'm currently involved is called Frontier Development Lab.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's a wonderful initiative. It's an AI research accelerator that takes place during summer for 8 weeks. And it brings together teams of four people, so two domain scientists and two research engineers, AI research engineers, software engineers, to tackle a problem for 8 weeks. And a problem from, you know, from the different domains of the NASA science portfolio. And then encourage them to share and publish their results afterwards. And we've seen great success with this program. In fact, some of the work that started in that program ended up, you know, being deployed in a real mission. So yeah, I think it's a very successful initiative, and I think that's definitely helping to bridge the gap.
Okay, so hopefully you all heard that Frontier Development Lab has intern positions every summer. So that those projects should be super exciting for anyone to apply to. So sorry, coming back to the business side of things, right? There is pretty much an infinite supply of problems that we can have that we have that can be solved by ML, but somehow not we don't put this about and throw that every single problem, right? So can you talk a little bit about what is lacking there in terms of like KPIs?
I think that's a great question in the sense that every company out there wants to do AI and machine learning, right? And we've already talked about research and data and models and things like that. I think the challenge that happens is lack of understanding of what AI and ML can enable for the product management department, right? So you start with any company, you can take Facebook, Twitter, they are big companies who have been doing machine learning for a while, and sort of they have had success stories of models being shipped into production, leading to revenue impact, right? So that builds trust in AI. Now we're talking about smaller companies who started with the promise of AI, mm-hmm. but don't have any success stories yet.
Mm-hmm.
So they have a limited runway to get that. And if they don't get that, they lose trust in, oh, AI doesn't work, or we're wasting our money, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it all comes down to really this misalignment between business metrics and KPIs to model metrics and KPIs, right? If we are talking about, say, a model that predicts the next word that you're going to type in like a essay writing or something, right? And you build that model in such a way that it has 80% precision, right? So that's still 20% error, right? And you go to a product manager and you say that what kind of metrics are you tracking? Like, well, I'm tracking user engagement. I'm tracking how many users, new users subscribe every month.
Right.
And you have 20% error. I don't think I can ship this model because the users are going to be disengaged or they're going to be unhappy, and so the conversation ends there, right? Whereas the conversation can start there, which is, this is where we are. You, the PM, tell us what you need as a target metric, and then build that sort of value chain analysis, which is, if we move precision from 80% to 90%, what is the change that lift that we expect in the business KPIs? And let's do targeted A/B tests iteratively, learn from it, and see which angle it moves. And Netflix has done that for years with multi-arm banded and very innovative ways of user testing. I think there was a presentation on it about which movie to recommend. So doing more of that is sort of bridging that gap between what was a model in open source or research to what is that targeted use case and what are the metrics for revenue impact, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then sort of educating that, doing a few things, educating that all the way to C-suite and executive level and evangelizing AI, that is sort of going to change the way people think about it. And it's not going to solve all the problems, but it's going to iteratively start having business impact, and then they start seeing it, so there's more investment, which leads to more data, more labels, and then sort of it's a loop that sort of organically keeps growing.
100%, I can identify with that. Like for Twitter, our vital metrics are the amount of time someone spends on Twitter, right, or the monthly active users.
Yeah.
That's our vital metric. But then the model improvements that my colleagues will make, they're moving some other metrics, right, like the search prediction, things like that. So definitely agree with that. I think having those two aligned and trying to make it more causal would be super useful. Ignacio, I wanted to talk to you about, you mentioned earlier more about like open source initiatives that NASA has, right? And can you touch a little bit more on what kind of incentives that that not just NASA, but like you can talk about for other companies to also implement to improve their contribution back into the open source repositories?
That's a good question. So some of the initiatives that I mentioned before with open science, I think that that's something that can be extrapolated to companies as well. Something I forgot to mention from the initiative is that it's more about a cultural shift.
Mm.
I mean, it's important to have a cultural shift, shared set of tools and standards to then, you know, release some of the data sets and AI artifacts that we develop. But create a culture in which, for example, if you have domain scientists, you can also educate them into the fundamentals of machine learning. Or you can bring into as well as people who work on data management, also bring in there and help them and teach them and educate them on creating data pipelines and be more organized and structured in the code, like basically like some code readiness as well. I think that always help. At the end of the day, I think it's super important, especially for people in research, they usually are like highly specialized people,
right,
to learn other skills from in this case like a tangent world as well, so that you can implement, you know, your skill set, but also from people that comes from you know, the computer science world, to maybe focus on or touch different domains and highly specialized domains, and maybe find interest there, or like find maybe an interesting use case, like using Marsh data to create an algorithm that detects critters, stuff like that. I think that's creating that sort of intersection, I think that helps.
Yeah. So I could talk to you both for probably another hour at the very least, right? But being cognizant of the time, I want to ask both of you one question, final question. If you had a magic wand, right, or if you had one genie wish, just not, don't say one more wish, but one thing that you would like to solve, like what would be the top thing that you would pick? I'll ask Sarb first, then Ignacio, you can go.
Yeah, one wish, that's hard. We talked about so many problems, right? Yeah, but I think, like I was saying before, let's start from the top of the funnel, is improve how we publish papers and improve how we publish code with papers and make it more, like I was saying, use case specific, right? Even in research, even in fundamental research, there is a problem you're trying to solve, right? Then connect that problem to the user and talk about it as a user problem, because or a business problem, right? So then from the beginning, you're thinking about the problem and its applicability.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, when it's published, most folks in the industry are constantly thinking about how to apply and how to ship. And sort of you reduce that that cycle of shipping. And then you learn faster, you grow faster in terms of AI, you know, what works, what doesn't work. And then, you know, it's like you try 100 experiments, 99 that did not work, actually, you know, you learn so much more than the one that you thought worked, but it actually didn't work. So.
Right.
Yeah, I would say for me, it's like increasing the level of trust in machine learning and AI in general, not just from the scientific community, but also from the public. I don't think that the media does a good job by creating that trust. I think it's good to be a skeptical. And more work needs to be done. Some of the solutions that we mentioned today, like for example, increasing you know, ways to reproduce research work, open sourcing more, have a better standards to publish as well. I've seen that right now. Last year we published in CDPR, and one of the requirements, it was optional, but one of the requirements that they, you know, they were qualified from, was to provide some sort of data they can run to demonstrate, to reproduce some of the work that you've done. So I think those are the right steps that academic venues can take right now and join us as well. Also, I think a higher emphasis is not just publishing paper models, but also publish data, highly curated data sets, as well as in other AI artifacts. I mean, at the end of the day, you know, doing all these kind of steps, what it's going to help is, you know, make models more understandable, especially like highly complex models. Also, I forgot about this, but all the work that is currently being done about like model cards and data cards,
mm-hmm.
I think coming from Google. For example, like if you publish a data set, you know, have some sort of documentation, standardized documentation about how did you select it, different labels.
Mm-hmm.
Also, if you publish a model, like what are some of the consequences that this model can have?
Yeah.
Like at least have that kind of discussion.
Excellent idea.
One of the, like for example, and this is obviously a hard problem to tackle, but if we develop a model and we predict plots, and you know, that the predict cost of plots, think at least about like what are the consequences that I can have for real estate, for example, or like
right.
The value of real estate in those areas. I mean, that's something hard to tackle, but it's a good start to at least you know, start thinking and having these conversations as you publish an open source model.
Yeah, I think the quote that comes to mind right now is with great power comes great responsibility. So if your model is predicting some really key or like use cases like like predicting flooding, then you have got to be careful of how it's going to be represented or misrepresented.
Yeah. And in healthcare, there are just so many you're focusing on wrong predictions, right? So, yeah.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much again for being here with us. We'll take a couple of, we have a few minutes, so we can take a couple of questions from the audience if they have any.